All right. So welcome, everyone, to this sixth live stream of EngineeringTrainer.com. My name is Luuk Hennen. I'm the founder of Engineering Trainer. And today we will have a conversation with Łukasz Skotny, who is the owner and lead designer at EnterFEA. And an FEA enthusiast in general, being a tutor and running a blog, enterfea.com/blog, which I highly recommend. And he's also the maker of the FEA Essentials course or the Breakthrough FEA course, which can be found on both engineeringtrainer.com and enterfea.com. Łukasz, welcome. It's an honor to have you. How are you doing?
Yeah, thanks, Luke, for having me. It's a pleasure to be here with you folks. So
awesome.
I'm actually fine, and I love live events. So I hope that we'll manage to have like some good discussions here and just fun. So
yeah, you know, I agree. Yeah.
Make yourself a good cup of tea or coffee, and let's roll.
Exactly. That's why we do these sessions. Today, Łukasz, we'll be discussing starting with FEA projects, how to optimize your learning curve. We'll be addressing topics like basic engineering knowledge needed, what to focus on, what to ignore, items to pay special attention to. For the viewers at home, like we intend to take, let's say, 1 hour, maybe a little bit longer, depending on the amounts of questions that we get. And I would also like to tell to everyone viewing to make sure to join the live chat. So please point your attention towards it for a second. I believe you have to log in to YouTube in order to see it. But make sure to use it. I mean, ask questions, share your thoughts, and we will make sure to address them in our conversation. And as a starting point, I mean, you will see me looking to the side every now and then. I think Łukasz will do the same thing. The chat is on this side. Please, for everyone watching at home, please at this moment share the location from where you are joining us. That's always a nice way to connect and see who's out there. In the meantime, I also invite you to follow our YouTube channel and also the channel of EnterFEA. LinkedIn pages, of course, or to connect directly with me or Łukasz on LinkedIn to start a conversation. And especially if you feel that an enterprise account to the Engineering Trainer Learning Platform would be beneficial for your team, make sure to shoot me a message such that we can explore the options. Having said all of that, we see a lot of responses coming in. That's amazing. We see Dominique, thanks for joining us from Montreal. Thomas from Germany, thanks for joining. Alwin from Kerala. We see Mexico, Belarus, Houston, France, India. All right, Denmark. Thanks for joining and let's have a good time. As a starter, Łukasz, I would like to ask you, like how did you start with FEA? How did you end up doing FEA?
Well, I actually started FEA by accident. I mean, I didn't even want it to.
Okay.
I always knew that I will do a PhD. My father has a PhD in engineering. So like, if you would ask me in eighth grade what I will do, I would tell you that I will go to university, do a PhD, start a company and have my own business. So the PhD was always in the plan. What I didn't know was that PhD will actually require FEA because, you know, normally you do like research and then you publish the research, you make conclusions. And my thesis tutor came and said like, hey, Łukasz, you know, like since, you know, it's 21st century already, you should do FEA as well. And my initial thought was, oh my God, matrix operations. I hate those. Like, right. I don't like complex mathematics. I never did, I guess. So to me, it was like a horror story. But so two like FEA manuals later, I knew that I will never learn it. My university had like a scientific abacus license. So I was like the only one using it, so I could use it non-stop basically. But on the flip side, I had no idea what I'm doing, so I was just clicking around. And the cool thing about PhD is that, you know, they ask you to do something and you just do it. Like, you don't consider something like backing off or not doing
right,
it. So
yeah,
I guess
committed.
This gave me the space that I actually effectively clicked around for a year or two to finally start making things work. And I remember, like, the first nonlinear analysis I converged, it took me like a year. And oh, like, really? I could explain
what year are we
like
talking about?
But right, I exactly, can start from zero.
What year are we talking about?
Oh, that was like 2008, 2009, something like that, because I finished my PhD in 2011 when I, yes, so that, it has to be somewhere around those. Like, funny enough, I always had problems placing things in time. So if you would ask me how many years I run my blog, I'm not certain. I would have to check that. Like, it's yeah, possible, yeah, yeah. But it's around that time.
All right, all right, all right. So that's been a decent amount of time. let's include the slides. Sure. You prepared a few of them to guide the conversation. All right, there they are. So yeah, fire away, Vukach.
Okay, I guess that I'm not like a super famous person, obviously. So my name is Łukasz Skotny. There are only a few things that you should know about me. And the first thing is that I'm kind of like a random guy from internet, right? So like, if you're an engineer and you want to base your engineering judgment on anything you learn from online resources, it's always good to question things, right? It doesn't mean that I'm super bad or I want to trick you in anything. I actually have a PhD in shell stability. For over a decade, I run my own company that does FEA design. So we're kind of good at it, and this is what we specialized in, to the point that we don't even do drawings anymore. We just do calculations all the time. And I've been a lecturer for almost a decade at Wrocław University of Technology, and I taught steel structures and mostly right. like shell structures like silos, tanks, those kind of things. So this is also my scientific background, obviously. I run a blog on enterfea.com/blog. You can read a lot about FEA there. And I do training in FEA and engineering design in general. And I do have very strong views on things. I think that this is also something you might want to know about me. Like, I've made my mind about several things, and why I'm always happy to discuss those. I'm also like hard to convince, because I will have my own arguments for and against some stuff. So some of the things that I will tell you might sound controversial even, but I do have more than 10 years of like industrial experience to back my saying. So
let's explore a few of them in the conversation. That's interesting.
Sure, topic. Sure. I'm always happy to. It's like, I far rather talk with someone who disagrees, because it makes the conversation interesting. Right? So as Luuk said today, we'll cover a few interesting topics that should help you start in FEA. And at this beginning, I would say that starting in FEA is not a simple thing. It's a great thing when you've done it, but it's not necessarily something I throughoutly enjoyed, like especially when you do it without guidance. So I will start with talking a bit about basic engineering skills. So the knowledge that it would be good to have before you even start, because without it, you might encounter troubles. And that's one thing. And then we'll talk about what FEA does, when you should use it, because it's not always obvious, what you want to learn, and what you don't want to not to learn. Because it's like, funny enough, with learning, sometimes the decision of what I won't learn is more important than what I will learn in the long run, because you have a finite amount of time at your disposal. And of course, we'll talk about why you need good foundations in FEA and what risks are hidden in what you do and when you don't have those. And few things you really should pay attention to when you do your first design projects. And if there's enough time, we can talk about things that I did wrong when I did my first projects, because it's always fun.
It is. Yeah, it is.
Yeah. Okay. So for basic engineering skills, the knowledge that you should have, funny enough, this is usually not related to FEA in general. So for instance, you should know things about what is stress. And, you know, like, it sounds kind of funny, because we're all engineers, so you know what stress is, right? But what I mean is a bit more than load applied to an area. You should really understand what's going on, right? Because FEA is really good at producing those beautiful pictures that are sometimes referred as engineering porn, because it looks awesome, right? But the fact is that, okay, now we have it. What now, right? And so, without understanding what stress is, you would really struggle to dig anything useful out of your FEA calculations. Yeah. Because frankly speaking, in like the time of internet, you already know that finding, like the informations are there, but there's so many information that it's not the problem of whether there is information on something, it's the skill of finding the proper information among everything you can find. So FEA is the same. It can calculate so many different things for you, and it will just give you like dozens over dozens of parameters. And only a few of those will be useful in your particular case. If you're not sure what you're searching for, like this would be tricky, right?
Yeah.
So to give you like a indication of what I mean and how I how I think about stuff and what I mean by understanding, let's take stress as an example. So when you were at university, you most likely saw Cauchy's stress tensor. Who knows, maybe there were even long differential equations flying around when this was on the blackboard, right? So you maybe know that if you'd rotate the Cauchy stress tensor, so something that FEA would produce for you, basically, you can get principal stresses, so that would be this, there are no shears, and I'm pretty certain there is a very long equation that does this for you, but your solver does it for you too, and it's only a press of a button, so equation is not really needed, right? Mm-hmm. But you still end up with the same problem, all right, so I have those stresses, what now? Because you would like to know whether something will fail or not, because that's design in a nutshell, right?
Yeah, right.
So so to make the distinction, you would have to know how much your material can survive, let's say. And to get that, you usually do tensile tests. You just cut out the specimen, you measure the elongation, you measure the force, you know the cross-section so you can calculate stresses, of course, and then you get a beautiful stress-strain relationship or force elongation from a simple test. And this basically informs you that, okay, at some point my material gives up and I know the stress value at which the material had enough. The problem with this is that the typical tensile test only gives you like one stress component. And like, I mean, come on, if you have one stress component, you can do calculations by hand. You don't need FEA. So you can be almost certain that in your case, the situation will be way more difficult than that, right? So now how to live with the fact that you know the strength of your material in a very simplistic place, and the outcomes you get are actually pretty complex. And you could do that in many different ways. There are many theorems about that. And basically the most important and the most well-known one, and important to me because I do metal structures mostly, is von Mises criteria, right?
Right.
Idea is that you say, okay, let's calculate the distortion energy of a small cubicle of my material. You can derive the equation for that, right? And then in a complex stress state, it would look like this. By the way, please do not note the equations. There is a good reason for it. For now, trust me. There will be a recording, so in the very worst case, if I lied, you can get back to them, but don't write the equations. Don't even read them. I just want to show that they exist, right? So then if you have a simple case, like in a tensile test, you can calculate the same distortion energy. It will be simplified simply because you have like a single component of stress. And then if you would compare both, essentially saying that I will treat that material failed in a complex state if the distortion energy in a given place is as high as the distortion energy in a simple tensile test case when my material failed, you can actually do some funky mathematics and ta-da, you end up with von Mises stress formula.
And
the cruel twist of FEA and higher education in general is that I'm pretty certain I knew those formulas by heart at some point. Like, sadly, I don't anymore. But there is a reason I told you not to write those down. There is a beautiful button in your FEA solvers, which is called calculate. And when you press it, one of those multiple colorful plots just shows you this. You don't have to know how to calculate that, but what you need to know is why do you even want to bother? Because, you know, right, there are like dozens of kinds of stresses. You have principal stresses, main stresses, like stresses in directions, shears, normals, like Tresca, whatever you like, right? And among all of those, there is this small line saying von Mises, and you can click it and boom, it shows you something. And what it shows is a mathematical torture of a very complex state that basically translate this complex state into one number you can compare with the tensile test result.
Yeah, I think, and it does. Yeah, just to jump in, Łukasz, for a second, like the way I always, when I encountered FEA for the first times, is as long as I understood these concepts, you know, going from a 1D stress state, which has been tensile tested, to a 3D stress state, which you are researching, understanding that was the main aspect. You know, you read the equations a few times, maybe you even deduce them, but I wouldn't be able to remember them at this very moment. I would have to admit.
Yeah, absolutely. And the problem with FEA in general is that you can find books and books worth of very complex mathematical equations. And somehow we managed to convince everybody that when you know those equations, everything will be fine. But the reality is that most of those are simply codified nowadays. You just press a button and the answer pop up. So you don't have to know how to translate them one to another. But what is critical is that among all those informations, you need to understand why you need those things. Not even how to calculate them. The computing is done. But why this particular one, what it means, how to interpret it, those are the questions that are needed today. Not necessarily how can I do it in Excel sheet or on a piece of paper, even though my exams looked like that. And we didn't have Excel sheets. We actually calculated with pen and paper.
So that's intense.
And yeah, it is. Like, especially since when you did like a calculation error, it would still count as an error. So it was pretty intense. But this is what I mean when I say that you need to have a very good basic engineering knowledge before you apply FEA. It's not how things work, but rather what I'm trying to achieve, to understand the possible outcomes, because FEA technically can calculate anything you want, but you need to want something, because calculating all of it doesn't work because it's too much information. You need to kind of know what you are aiming for. And of course, stresses is not the only thing you should understand, but it's like a vital thing, mostly because it's on pictures, right? You will look those up. But you also should know what strain is, the rate at which the material deforms, and what it actually means that there is a strain in a material. And
right,
to be fair, when you are starting, the strain may not be the most important part, mostly because you will most likely do linear analysis. So all the non-linearities that happen between in a relation between stress and strain will kind of be like out of reach, at least at the beginning. But when you reach a certain level, you start doing nonlinear materials, understanding strains is actually something pretty important. So that's definitely something I would point out as a thing you would really like to know, like you should really pay attention to. The same goes with rigidity. When I was a student, and a lecturer would explain something that was super complex, they would usually say something like, oh, this depends on a spatial work of a structure. And it would be like a magic spell that every time something difficult is encountered, you can just invoke the spell of spatial rigidity and it's like it's solved. That's right. So this must have been one of the most frustrating terms in engineering in my life. Because every time I was uncertain about stuff, someone said spatial rigidity. And you're like, what am I supposed to do with that?
What does it mean?
But the reality of rigidity is that it's actually a very simple phenomenon. If you have rigid elements and not rigid elements supporting the same thing, the rigid elements will take the load and not rigid element won't. This is why we don't build stuff from gummy bears, basically. Yeah. Right? Yeah. And again, I'm pretty certain that rigidity could be described in many differential equations. But luckily for you, FEA does the calculations for you, so you don't need the equations. But what you definitely need to understand is that when you have a structure and part of it is not loaded, it doesn't necessarily mean that it's like an error of some sort. Maybe it's just way less rigid than anything else and it just didn't take the load. And maybe it's a mistake on your end as a user of FEA.
You
have to strengthen it. Maybe the design requires rethinking of something, right?
Yeah.
So it's all those funny stories you can tell to your grandmother on her birthday about your work that explain the reality that counts. because your grandma doesn't care how to solve a differential equation of certain degree to reach somewhere, but she really likes stories about gummy bears, right? So if you understand stuff when you can explain it to your mom or your dad, if they happen to be like, a language major or someone non-technical, this is the understanding that you should have. And the equations are just there floating around somewhere in the background. And we'll get to those later on as well.
That's a fair point. Just to jump in a little bit, like I told you, Łukasz, I have a master's in applied physics, so not engineering.
Yeah, it's a scary concept.
But when I finished and started working and encountered FEA as a professional, what really helped me to better understand the concepts and the models that I was working on is to do these force balances, right? Like really have a deep dive into force balances. And I guess that's kind of what you're saying here with rigidity. If you understand the forces and how they would kind of have to play out, then it's much more easy to understand the response of your model.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, like this is also sometimes referred to as load paths, like how the load travels through your model. Right. So yeah, that would be something like that. And the last important concept I want to use here, there are of course more, and in the course, there are many of those like described in detail. But what I want to mention is stress peaks and stress concentrations and stress singularities, because it's like you can beat any FEA user with that. The harsh truth is that stress concentrations happen in your structure, whether you like it or not, regardless if you calculate them or ignore them. So when you do pen and paper calculations, you don't have the tools to take stress concentrations into account, so you just ignore them, and then that's not a problem. But FEA, when you model everything, it actually sees the stress concentration and displays the problem that was always there. So it's not like FEA is stupid that show you weird things. It's just that we got used to ignoring problems, and in time we got very efficient at it. So of course, there is something called stress singularity, which would be like FEA getting a bit dumb about how big the stress is in a certain place and like goes into infinity.
Easy to get intertwined and get confused about.
Yes, that's true, right? Infinity is a bad number to divide by anything. I agreed with that. But at the same time, in reality, in this place, you still have a problem you have to deal with. It won't be like infinite amount of stress. The stress amount will be finite for sure. But at the same time, it will most likely be very high. So I know people who developed a strategy of let's ignore stress concentrations because they are like a stupid FEA mistake. This is not how it works. Like if you have a single support on an entire concrete slab, things are happening under that support. And while it may not necessarily be infinite amount of stress, it's a very, very high amount of stress, and you still have to deal with it. Like you can ignore all you want. That's your call. But I would be just careful with that. And I feel that those opinions of FEA doesn't work, especially when it comes to like stress singularity, comes from people not understanding the basics of it. Not necessarily why you get an infinite amount of stress when you apply a singular load, but the fact that if you apply a very small load on a very small area, you get a huge stress and you have to deal with it anyway, FEA or not.
Yeah.
And that's something
so
amazing.
So how would you, differentiate, what would your tactics be between singularities and peak stresses?
Well, first of all, this would depend on what kind of analysis you want to try to do. Like I design metal structures mostly, so I'm super comfortable about those things because I know that the material will yield and it will even things out. Yeah. And that works as long as I can allow material to yield. Because if I have cyclic loading, the yielding is not an option because it will go into like low cycle fatigue and it will crack in like several tries. So I can destroy the part. And like if I have a brittle material, there is no yielding or like plastic redistribution of stresses anyway. So again, like I'm dead in the water. In most of my projects, I just assume that the material is nonlinear and I can run the analysis and see how this stress would distribute in reality in my model. It doesn't mean that it's okay. It just means that it's solvable. And then me as an engineer, I need to analyze whether I like it or not. In linear analysis, this is more tricky because let's say I have a glass panel and there is like a small opening there because I need to attach it or whatever, it causes a stress concentration. It's real. It's there. Like, there are differential equations that would allow you to calculate the stress peak by hand. So it's not an FEA thing, and it's a real problem. And frankly, you either have to change loads, change geometry, maybe make the hole bigger or smaller to work around to achieve a stress in a stress concentration zone that is actually lower than allowable, because otherwise your glass will simply break.
Yeah.
And like, there are no work, like, simple life workarounds of divide the stress you got from FEA by 7 and everything will be fine or something like that. Like, it's not a magic spell. This is a real technical problem you have to deal with, and FEA has nothing to do with that. And of course, if you apply a single point load to a glass panel, under the load there is an infinite amount of stress, so it will never work. But then the simple solution would be, okay, since this is such an important case, let's model this load on an area that it will actually be applied on. Because while FEA shows infinite amount of stress, it doesn't mean that you can ignore it and nothing will happen. Like, there is a load you can apply on a small area on a glass to break it.
Yeah, yeah.
You have to just calculate how much load that is and if your glass is strong enough. So modeling things a bit more accurately in those cases is pretty significant. And when you do fatigue analysis of details, those models are crazy accurate, like insanely accurate sometimes. In those critical places, those can be insanely accurate. Like, you would model weld with solid elements and stuff like that, right? So this, there is a lot of complexity hidden somewhere underneath it.
And is it like, maybe it's like a simplification, but knowing whether you're dealing with a singularity and like knowing where the singularity ends and the peak stress stops, my thoughts go to meshing, right? And maybe fine tuning that and anything. But I would say, I mean, for me, as when I first encountered FEA, like, that was definitely a little bit confusing. And to be confident about,
sure,
like,
sure,
what, which
sure
of the two are we talking about?
Yeah, it is like, meshing is definitely part of the solution. It's not all of it, but at least part of it. And I see that Milad asked if like nonlinear analysis is a solution to deal with stress singularities. Well, it will definitely make things easier because the stress will plastically redistribute to a nearby element. You will see how much plastic strain you will get from that. You will see how big zone of yielding happens. And of course, there are ways to analyze whether this zone is too big or not, and so on and so forth. So yeah, definitely it makes things easier to analyze. But like, you cannot expect just that, oh, material is nonlinear, so this is fine. Like, there are instances where this just won't work. So,
right.
So you will actually have to use nonlinear analysis instead of doing linear analysis and hoping for the best, kind of. Like, it's not so so simple. And like, those would be the parts, like the basic engineering skills that I cover in the course, but also I think that are genuinely needed, not only in FEA, but in like engineering in general. Like, this is why they are called basic engineering skills, because like, even if you do not use FEA, they are still extremely important. And now, very briefly, what FEA does and when to use it. Well, the shortest answer I can give you is that in structural design, FEA does this. No matter how complex shape you have, as long as you know how to load it, how to support it, you will get an actual stress distribution throughout this element. You can get deformations of the elements, strain in the material, a lot of parameters, and it will just gives you that. So that's all cool. Like, you can analyze insanely complex things as long as you know how to support them, load them, and so on. We'll get there soon. But then if you are efficient and doing FEA, the problem is that when you have a good hammer, everything starts to look as a nail. And I wouldn't necessarily advocate using FEA everywhere. Well, that's just not feasible, especially since I would very quickly encounter a situation where someone would said, you know, 50 years ago, nobody used FEA and we still build the pyramids and, you know, stuff like that, right? And this is all true. So basically, FEA helps you to solve engineering problems, but it's not the only way. Like, first of all, we can do like physical prototyping, testing, Right. You can build a prototype, test it in hydraulic press or whatever, and check if it works as you want. The funny thing with tests is usually that everybody believes in tests apart from the guy who set up the test conditions, because it's very hard to mimic the reality in a test. You have to simplify a lot of things. And I'm not saying tests are wrong. They are great. It's just, it's not necessarily the answer to all of your questions, plus they cost a lot, but it's definitely a thing, right? And then the second part of the solving problem could be simple equations, right? There are things we can simply calculate by hand. And if you have an equation that very accurately describe a reality, don't use FEA, just use the equation. FEA will be a waste of time every time. But the problem with equations is that usually they are not as accurate as people think. And it's just a safe side estimate of a very complex problem, right? And then you have very conservative outcomes when you use many pen and paper procedures. And this is how we did that in the past, right? There is a reason why 30 years ago, a typical whole building would weigh 100 kilonewtons per square meter of floor. And now it's 20. You can literally build several buildings out of one we did design several years ago. We know so much, we can calculate it so much more accurately that we don't have to guess anymore about things, and we don't have to have those extra safety margins. But it comes as a cost. And the cost is the complication of things we have to analyze. And this is where FEA comes in. So you either solve problems you don't know equations to. Take a look at this part. How would you imagine an equation that would allow you to calculate this stress distribution?
Right. It's that's crazy. Right?
And at the same time, often you will know that the codes are pretty conservative in this hand formula. So let's do FEA and see how conservative they are. I'm not suggesting lightly ignore the codes, do the FEA, you're fine. It really requires finesse, experience, and knowledge to do that. But I also honestly have to say that there are things that are just roughly estimated in codes. And when you do non-linear FEA or FEA in general, you can really verify stuff more accurately. And this is where it shines, not in the simple hand calculations you can do. Those will always be quicker. Just do an Excel sheet, punch a few numbers, you have the outcome. It's always better than FEA.
Yeah, that makes sense. I told you a little bit about my background when preparing for this conversation, which is mostly projects in pressure vessels. And there you encountered the ASME, boiler and pressure vessel code, which has this division one section, which a lot of equation to design the pressure vessels. But then there's this small section allowing for FEA to be utilized, whenever you have custom features or, custom designs that are not really within the scope of the equations. And that's basically how I experienced using FEA. Yeah.
Yeah, sure. Absolutely. So that's the magic. This is also why FEA is considered to be an expert tool, because it makes no sense to solve simple cases with FEA. So naturally, when you do FEA, you do those more complex, more expert-like work. So it's actually a nice field to work in. So what to learn first and what to ignore? That's my favorite part. I love this part of the discussion. So we are getting to the engine part. So first of all, you need to answer a simple but very important question. What do you want to do? And you have basically two choices. You can do what I do, and that would be design with FEA, or you can do the other stuff, which would be writing your own solver. And if you want to write your own solver or work in a company that does that, and trust me, this is a nice career. I'm not saying it's not. I'm not sure if it's engineering career, but it's definitely a well-paid job. You can just buy all the FEA books out there, learn all the mathematics, learn how to code in few languages, and you're basically an IT mathematical person who writes a solver that I will buy from you to do the design. But the big thing is that we start to confuse those two roles, thinking it's only a one role. But it's two. It's like with cars. You can either be the guy who design and maintain engine in a car, or you can be a race driver. And a good mechanic is not a good race driver, and a good race driver is definitely not a good mechanic. It's just a different kind of job. So if you want to write your own solver, first of all, don't listen to my advice. I'm even though I do code in few languages, I will never code my own solver. I'm just too stupid for that. Like, I missed, like, I don't know, a PhD in mathematics and a lot of matrix operations, I guess. So, sorry, I just can't help you. But the good thing is that most universities teach FEA extremely theoretically, which means that you most likely had in your FEA classes all the equations needed to code the solver. What you lack is like programming skills, making this work faster, more efficient, stuff like that. It's IT. It's not like an engineering problem at this point. But if you want to use FEA in design, so what I do, then you should focus on a few simple yet very important things. The first one is how to do decent geometry. That would be like, you know, when you want to design something, you need to how to model it, what you can ignore. And ignoring part is actually pretty important. You don't want to ignore too much, but you definitely don't want to ignore too little either. Right. So that's the part, right? Then boundary conditions. Like, I use caps lock, so you can feel that it's serious, but I only use two exclamation marks, so I'm not desperate. But definitely boundary conditions are the important part. Like, I've seen so many very complex calculations done stupidly because someone simply assumed that something will be pinned supported or fixed supported, like right. out of nowhere. And you're looking at it and you're like, whoa, that, like, this won't fly. And to me, boundary conditions is the most important part of engineering in general and FEA especially. So definitely pay attention there. It's good to know essential of meshing, and I even specifically wrote not too much because it's very easy to like go down into the rabbit hole of shape functions and like pH things and, you know, all of that. Now, you don't want that, but you, like, it's not as critical as you think, and we'll get there at the end. But at the same time, you just don't want to do, you know, like, just mesh it and move on. It's right. like, it's more subtle than that. So there is an equilibrium there you need to find. Not go too deep, but then don't ignore it completely. And
it's easy, like, to go too deep. I mean,
but it's
just so much. You want to have the perfect model and the perfect mesh before you think you can have good results. But
yeah. But it's definitely also easy to go way too shallow on it. And since I have a blog, people sometimes send me questions and they send me like, look, I have this model and can you like advise me what to do? And when you look at the mesh, you're like, whoa, the fact that you managed to compute this is like, it's a miracle on its own. Right?
So two cores, you mean?
It's like, but also sometimes you make weird choices, like choice of element selection, whether I want to mesh it in 2D elements, 3D elements.
Right.
Some of those like questions are things that people never asked themselves. Like, you very rarely found a person who would tell you that 2D mesh in most cases is actually more accurate than 3D mesh. People would argue otherwise because it's counterintuitive. But when you do shell structures, most of the time, that's actually the case. Mm-hmm. And you have to simply have the basics understanding of, you don't need to do mathematics. You just need to know what the conclusion of the mathematics are, right? Mm-hmm. So then, of course, understanding outcomes is important. So you need, like, you know, you have those beautiful engineering porn pictures, and now you have to say, is it okay or not? Like, the picture doesn't say right. okay or not okay. It shows you a lot of stuff. You need to kind of deal with that somehow, right? So that this is something I would focus on. It's very easy to follow like two paths of being too conservative or being too relaxed. Conservative person would be, I got stresses higher than yield in linear analysis. We are all gonna die, right? And the relaxed person would be like, no matter, like, let's just ignore this part, right?
So right.
there's a fine line again. And you don't want to go too deep. You don't want to go too shallow. And when you start learning FEA, I beg you, start small. Like, there is a good reason that in the course there are like simple examples, because I had so many people send to me like, hey, I'm just starting in FEA, how to model the beating heart. And you're like, you need like 10 professors and 10 year grant to pull this off, right? How do you think that you beginner can like just pull this out of the head somehow, right? So no, like, start small, do small things, because this is how you build your confidence. This is how you see that you actually solve things that have solutions and those solutions make sense. Because if you start big, you basically destine yourself to fail. But then you will feel like, I cannot design a rocket. I'm just a single guy, right? So it's obvious that I failed. But such an experience doesn't teach you anything. And when you do something,
It's also highly motivating. I mean, seeing like these simple structures that you can understand from a non-FEA perspective, and then seeing, you know, being able to mimic them numerically, that I always found that really motivating.
Oh, and
I once had you heard you saying like this ruler. You know, if you have a ruler on your desk, you know, just put it on the side of your desk, start deforming it, maybe measure the deflection, try to measure the force, and just see when it breaks and see if you can mimic that. That's an interesting benchmark.
Yeah, exactly. And you know, it's actually not simple. You really have to hope that you have like a metal ruler that yields instead of like brittle ruler that breaks, because modeling breaking material is actually pretty complex. So, you know, even if in a daily life with a 1,000 element model, you can make it extremely complicated. It's not how big the model is. In fact, the smaller models allow you to pay more attention to details, which means that it's easier to spot that you've mistaken. And that's something people like usually run away from, while being mistaken is the only way you can learn. So you try to do something, obviously you failed, the outcomes you got is wrong, but now at least you have a feedback. Don't do those kind of problems this way. It doesn't work, right? So those smaller models really help. But as I said at the beginning, what to learn is only part of it, because the bigger part in my understanding of learning is what not to learn or what to ignore. And if you start with FEA, for the love of my life, if you really want to use FEA in design, don't learn mathematics. I mean, I have a PhD and I used FEA in PhD. I have like a company that does it nonstop for years now. I have a decade as a lecturer. I couldn't solve a differential equation if my life depended on it. Like, okay, if you gave me like internet access in a few hours, I would kind of like Google around and like find it. But like, if you just give me like an equation, pen and paper, I'm done. I wouldn't even start. I would start drawing flowers around the equation.
Right. But yeah, I think that's an interesting point. Like, you always hear like you have to understand the basics, but then the question is, okay, so what are the basics? Point that you're making here is like, if you really want to understand the equations, it's a dedicated career. You're starting to code your own solver kind of level of understanding. That's not the path you should go into too deep if you wanted to designing. That's basically what I hear you saying.
Yeah, absolutely. And to drag the analogy of a car driver and a mechanic a bit more, you can be the best mechanic out there. It doesn't mean that you know the rules of driving a car. You may not understand stopping on red, starting on green, the guy on the right goes first and stuff like that. You simply may not understand the road signs and stuff, right? Because if you think about it, like, let's say you're a race driver, you go to the mechanic and say like, hey, you've changed the engine in my car, should I know something, right? And the guy pulls out like 10,000 schematics and start to explain how the gasoline goes there, like injection stuff. Like the good driver would be like, mate, like, I'm not building an engine. I just want to drive a car. Like, when, like, should I shift the gears sooner or later? Now, right? Like, what sound does it make when I go too fast? And stuff like that. It's not the same skill set. So mathematics won't help you with most problems. Like, there is no differential equation you can calculate that will tell you how to properly support your model. There's simply no. Like, because if it would be, there would be a solver doing this for you. And it would be a very expensive solver, trust me. So no, you don't have to do that. The shape functions are like the best example of it, because everybody is like, yeah, finite element shape functions, let's go, like, let's do those by hand and stuff. Like, no, just don't. Like, the solver does it for you. I mean, let's assume that you're an expert in a field and you know a very critical mistake often made in shape functions. How the hell will you check if the software you bought from a company they've been developing in 30 years avoided this mistake? The only thing you can do is do a benchmark. So solve a problem where you know that this will happen and see if the outcome is correct or not. Guess what? You can do a benchmark even if you don't understand the mistake. All you need is to know the benchmark and correct answer. You just press play and it's either right or wrong. You don't need all this deep knowledge underneath. This is for the guys who write those programs. And if you aspire to be one, more power to you. That's great. This is just not what I do, right? And
so, maybe a side question you write shape functions. So I would estimate that it's still useful to understand the concepts of why what is a shape function? Why is it there?
And yeah, absolutely. Like there is even a lesson in the course called Mesh and Mathematics, because it's MMM, it's super funny. But like you don't have to understand the equations and how to calculate them. All you need is like, okay, look, the FEA does this. It calculates displacement. Based on those, it calculates strains. Based on those, it calculates stresses. So you need to pay attention to the good shape of an element, because otherwise the mathematics get funky and the values you get will be stupid. So, you know, those are very rough guidelines that you can like 10 commandments of meshing, let's say. And
right.
You don't really need to derive anything when you deliver the 10 commandments. You just have to follow those. So, yeah. Also, and I say this with broken heart. Initially, when you start learning FEA, please ignore nonlinear stuff. I mean, I know it's cool. There will be nonlinear animations here too.
They look wonderful. Yeah.
It looks beautiful. I get it. There will be time in your career when you'll do it, but don't start there, because this is how I started. Converging the first nonlinear shell buckling took me a year. Oh, wow. It wasn't a fun year. Like, I didn't enjoy it one bit. I just had to do it to finish a PhD. Like if this would be like a project, I would just like shut down my company or something. So you really don't want to start there. So in essence, don't do tasks that are just too complex. Like I had people asking me how to model a bone of a leg of a person climbing a stair. What kind of answer do you expect me to give you on such a question, right? There are so many complexities in there that I can't even wrap my head around the problem in general. But if you would say, okay, I'm calculating this like plastic or metal ruler and I apply the load and somehow it doesn't work, like at least it's something you can grasp, something you can fight with and hopefully find the solution to as well. So definitely start ignore the too complex things, because it will just frustrate you to no end.
Right.
So good foundations when using FEA and why you need them. That's almost like a continuation of what we just said, because there is only one good foundation in FEA, and that is you. Like if you're a good engineer, you understand what you're doing. FEA is just a tool. If it will show you a stupid outcome, you look at it and say like, this is a really stupid outcome. Right. And this, like, you're the only person that can check that for you, basically. Right. So it's your skill set, your understanding of what you're doing that counts the most. And one could say, yeah, like deriving the equations, maybe this, or maybe even like knowledge of some sort. But in reality, it's your engineering judgment. And frankly, it doesn't come cheap and it doesn't come fast. It will take you time to build confidence on how to do FEA properly, what's at stake, what things to consider, what to pay attention to. So it's always good to start with a mentor, like perhaps a senior engineer in your company or like at university, a professor who knows what he's doing into this kind of stuff. So starting alone is very difficult, but especially when you start alone, start with simple things you can measure yourself, or at least you have tasks that you know the correct answer of. Because if you just model things, whatever, then you will always get an outcome. And the problem with FEA is that whatever you do, FEA will always look smart. I mean, come on, this already looks like a proper answer. And it doesn't even matter what the question is. Like when you show someone this, everybody's like, whoa, that's like decent stuff. Like they did a great
job. Right.
And it gets even worse, because when you go into nonlinear stuff, you can animate this. And people are like, whoa, that's like, that's next generation things. Like you can see the failure. This goes down.
Advanced stuff.
It's advanced stuff, right? And the funny thing is that you can start to convince yourself. And that's the most dangerous part. Because if you don't have like sufficient knowledge about the problem you're solving, I actually did this once. We were solving a dust filter. And by accident, I didn't click to include one of the main loads. And like, you know, there was a checkbox. I just like click near it and didn't see that it was not checked. I ran the analysis and, you know, the outcomes were stupid. I look at them and like, that's wrong. Right? But then I thought, maybe that's not wrong. Maybe it's just more complex than I think it is. So I started to ponder what could happen to the outcomes to look like that, right?
Right.
After a few hours of thinking, I had a perfect, reasonable theory why the answer is correct and why it looks like this. Like, I had in my head all those schematics of how the load travels, like what happens where, and so on and so forth. And I was damn sure that it's okay. And I was even happy that it was an unexpected outcome, but I managed to figure out why this is the case.
Right,
but luckily,
in
my office, from the very early days, we had a rule that someone else checks your work. And like a person working there check it and say, like, you didn't click the big load. And I was like, okay. And you actually feel sad because it was such a wonderful theory why this could be correct, right?
Yeah.
So convincing someone else is easy. I mean, I could do FEA in Photoshop if I knew how to use Photoshop. I just paint it, like, slap a few colors, go to a meeting and say, like, yeah, these are the outcomes, you know, it looks like that. You could, like, a 20-year-old could generate a reasonable stress distribution plot. If you would show them, like, 20 example ones, they would basically know, oh, the red is near the corner, the green is in the middle, and you can literally fake it. Right? Convincing someone else, it's doable. But if you start to convince yourself to stupid outcomes, this is where it gets really bad.
Sounds dangerous. Yeah.
Yeah. And it really is, right? Engineering is a very serious job. So, you know, when you do something like that, this is a free fall object hitting a relatively not stiff shell. How will you know if this even works? I mean, like, it looks plausible, obviously, right? Actually, this one doesn't include a few things that make it not very correct. But it looks like, right? Like, if you look at it, it was like, yeah, this actually looks realistic, but it's just stupid, right? And FEA will always look smart. So it's you who have to know what is smart and what is not smart, because if you will convince yourself that what you're doing makes sense, this is where problems start.
So let's say you're running into a project or you're performing a project like, what strategies do you use to like check your work or to make sure that you're not fooling yourself? Like
okay,
any
first
ideas?
Of all, yeah, absolutely. First of all, like, we have like a rule set for that. So first of all, I would ask someone else to check it. And frankly, it's nowadays it's like people doing the models and they finish and then I check it. So like it would be the other way around. But generally, always, every project gets to be done by one person and checked by another person internally. Because, like, if you convince yourself about certain assumptions, you will never catch yourself. Someone else has to look like, hey, why did you assume that? It's stupid. And as soon as they ask the question, you instantly know that it's stupid. But if they didn't ask the question, you're just dead in the water. Like, you just assume it. You're happy with the assumption. So, like, you wouldn't notice that. So that's one. Secondly, when we do FEA, I always ask my employees to make a piece of paper, write down all the load cases and load combinations, estimate what the reaction forces we expect, calculate each of those in the model,
right,
and check if the loads are what you expect. And of course, if you estimate it, you will never be like 100% correct, because it's just an estimate in many cases. But if something is like five times off, then it's like, well, something didn't work. I don't know what. But like, it's impossible to get an outcome like that, right? Also, all those small stress calculations you can do by hand, right? If you have a beam and you know the section modulus, you can calculate the stress by hand in bending and just see if the FE shows you something like that, right? To the point that since we use like mostly work in shells and shell stability, I kind of know how to estimate the outcomes because I have a PhD in a field. So I know that if I do a certain code calculations, the nonlinear FEA will show something like 50-60% higher capacity. So if it shows lower capacity, maybe there are mistakes. If it shows way higher capacity, there are definitely mistakes, right? So you kind of, like, people will often tell you, oh, you should expect the outcome before you start FEA. And I mean, yeah, that would be ideal, but you will start to know what outcome to expect after several years in the field. So how the heck are you going to learn it before? So it's either having a mentor, maybe doing hand calculations and just learn. Last time it was like two times the hand calculation. Now it's seven times. Something is off here, right? See the simple relations. Also, oftentimes you can do, even in pressure vessels, you can calculate hop stresses with relatively simple formulas on simple section, right? So just find this part of the shell that is without anything else. Calculate the stress by hand, compare, it should be more or less there. Not necessarily like perfectly there, but at least close enough. So we can say, yeah, this makes sense, right?
I would say, like, you mentioned, like search for a part in the model that to which you can compare hand calculations. One way of going at it is like making your model complex step by step while you do some checks that you can still relate to with engineering judgment. And then once these work out according to your judgment and hand calculations, you know, you add features that make it like the response much, much more difficult. At least that's something that helped me out in the past a few times.
I usually, it's funny because we have a different approach to this, actually, because I would do it the other way around. I would do the most complex version because I would be afraid that while adding complexity to your model, you can actually damage something and not notice that. So dumbing down your model is kind of safer in my eyes, but it only depends on what industry you work in and what examples do you do, right? Because I can easily imagine that your proposal would work just as well. It kind of like depends on what you're doing, really. But yeah, like making a simpler model to see if this still works or not, and then like trying to understand the problem from a broad perspective, that's a very good thing. And I remember that when I started with FEA, my father would say something like, oh, you did this beautiful FEA, that's great, but you know, I did these calculations and I divided this by this and the answer should be around 7 and yours is 20. What's up with that? And I was furious. I was like, come on, don't you understand? This is an FEA. This is an advanced stuff. And he was like, son, it's like 20 divided by 3.
Like, right.
There's
right,
not
right.
much margin for negotiations here.
Yeah. Well, if you're able to do it, some parts by hand, that's really beneficial.
Absolutely. Especially since after you start hitting those checks, time and time again, you build confidence that what you do makes sense. And this confidence is equally important in normal work. So that would be something. And then the last part is what you should pay attention to in your first FEA projects. So the first part, I think I won't surprise you. It's a Dunning-Kruger curve. So when you start, you will know nothing, right? And it's a frustrating part where you have to just click around and try stuff. And suddenly, this stuff will start to work for you. And this is the place where you need to be very, very careful. Like, because, you know, FEA looks smart, but you don't know all there is to know yet. So be careful, because it's very easy to make stupid mistakes, sadly. And it can be dangerous, right? And in time, when you especially compare your outcomes to the known result, like a test result, or maybe scientific article, and you do those simple cases first, you will learn that, oh, I've made a mistake here, I usually made a mistake there. You kind of like straighten yourself out. You know how to do it more, so you become more efficient at it. And then this is the part when you actually start to develop skills that will allow you to become like an FEA wizard, and you can then solve all the problems out there, regardless of their class, because you can just, as long as you know how to load it and how to support it, and there are always people who know more or less what the load should be in a given industry, the rest is in your head and you can just do it. So FEA is also a nice tool if you want to move around industries, because it's actually pretty difficult to find a person who knows FEA on a good enough level to calculate complex stuff. Those people are usually sought for. So first of all, when you start and you're really doing those first few projects, I know how exhilarating it can be when you press calculate for the 7th time and the first time you don't see non-convergence. It just tells you the outcome and you feel like the master of it all. And that's cool. That's a great feeling. I'm happy for you already. But please be critical of what you've got. Think this through. Ask people around. The fact that you see an answer on your screen doesn't mean the answer is correct. It just means that the solver spit out some numbers and painted beautifully over your model. It's not necessarily the correct answer. So be careful there. That would be the biggest advice. But to be more specific than that, don't overdo geometry. I mean, when you will be starting with FEA, geometry is the only thing you control.
It's tempting,
You kind of like, you have a full control over the geometry. So people usually tend to overcompensate for what they are not sure in the other areas, like focusing too much on geometry. And I usually told my students at the university, look, if they will build the structure you design and someone will move a column by several millimeters and the building failed, it's not a problem of the column. Like, this cannot impact the outcome so severely. And that's in a part, like, I'm sure that if you would spend enough time, you would figure out the place where this is actually not true. But in general sense, that would be the case. And in most cases, overdoing geometry does only two things for you. One, meshing will be a total nightmare. And two, you will waste a lot of time, which means that in the end, when you will have to produce the report, you won't have enough time to think about boundary conditions, analyze the outcomes, think through if what you've got is good or not, because you wasted too much time on doing too accurate geometry. And this is something that I did myself too. Like, I mean, like, come on, like, there wasn't a hole I wouldn't model in FEA when I was starting, right? And it also takes experience to a certain level to say, okay, I know that this won't be a problem, this will be a problem.
Right.
Because you cannot ignore everything gilly-willy and just model a straight line. I actually saw once a model where someone modeled a silo that was like 20 meters high, 12 meters of diameter. They just modeled it as a simple beam, a pipe with a concentrated load on top. The stress was like, you know, 0.001 megapascal, so they assume that it's okay, you know?
Right,
like,
right.
Nah, that's not the level of simplicity you want to attain, but doing things too complex will hurt you in the long run. So simplifying geometry, definitely. Also, be very careful about supports. And like, I cannot stress this enough. Like, I'm actually more afraid of people who know how to do very complex analysis. Like, you can pull out an explicit solution of something crazy out of your sleeve. But when you lack in basics, this is like the most scary thing, because, you know, you rightfully so think about yourself as an expert in a certain domain, but it's very hard to realize that while being an expert, you really lack in the basics. Like, it's not something you can tell to your boss.
Right.
Right. So boundary conditions are like, I think that this is the most important part of engineering work in general, but in FEA especially. So this is something I would really, really pay attention to.
Which can be difficult, right? Boundary conditions.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Understanding the nuances, like
yes,
like, you know, really difficult.
We talked about gummy bears and rigidity. There could be like rigidity of support. Which directions are supported? Which directions aren't supported? It's not
friction,
easy.
Like, bolting. Yeah.
Absolutely, a friction is this one of those parameters that's always there when you don't need it, and is never there where you actually do. Like, absolutely, you're right. Like, it's, I'm not saying this is simple. Like, I mean, in the course there is an entire module on boundary conditions, right? It's like a huge thing. But in the end, you need to know why you supported this area in this direction, right? And if you want to know how I think about those things, imagine a simply supported beam. It has a sliding support on one end and not sliding support on another. And my question is, what is the difference in reality between those two? And if you cannot answer those questions, you don't understand the boundary conditions.
Yeah.
Because usually people have the same two ends and they will just nilly-willy assume that one is sliding and one is not. And my question is always the same. Why did you assume that? Like, it doesn't have to be like that, right?
Yeah.
But it's so ingrained. Because why? Because when you learn static design at university, they can assume whatever boundary conditions they like, because this is not the complexity of the task. But in real life, when it's not you doing the hand calculations, but the solver doing the calculations, it's the boundary conditions that are most important.
Yeah,
and
right.
We are not prepared, right? So also checking if the loads are realistic, that would be like a pretty important part. And I mean realistic as compliant to the code, but also like in your head, like, does it even make sense? And I like to use an example. Imagine you have a huge safe, a very wide, very heavy safe, and you want to support it on two beams, and those beams deflect like crazy. This means that the safe stays, but the beam deflects, so it stands only on the corners. So this is like basically four corners that apply the load to the beams. It's not a uniformly distributed load along the length of the beam, because the beam runs away from the safe and the safe is not moving, right? So when do you know if the load will follow your model or not? Like, does it is important, right? Like, you shouldn't ignore it, but usually people just say, slap pressure there and it will be okay, right? And I was like, no, not necessarily. This is not the same task, sadly, right?
That's a difficult example, yeah.
Oh, yeah, it is. But it's so simple at the same time, you know? That's the understanding. You can nail a very complex phenomenon using very simple equations, examples, sorry. And if you can't, this just means that you don't understand it well enough. Because everything that is complex have a very simple, very complex case in it, right? So find the perfect middle with meshing. Don't overdo meshing. I mean, like, you don't have to read 2,000 pages on how shape functions calculate in various element types to be good at meshing, but don't ignore it either. It's not like a, you know, concrete building, half by half meter, finite elements supported in one point and everything will be fine. Right? No, don't go there. But at the same time, you don't want to stress it out too much because, you know, many people have no idea what how meshing works, what to do, and still we are all here and things are not failing. Unless you're designing a Sleipner A platform, which actually failed because someone did a wrong mesh. And that was like the main reason. They had two big elements and they had too little rebars in concrete structure as a result of that. So, you know, it does play a role. That's true. But at the same time, don't overdo it because you will spend so much time learning about it that you will fail to learn everything else. So I would way more focus on boundary conditions first and just do meshing that, like, you know, go online. You can go to my blog, look around the models I show there and just say, okay, the decent mesh looked like what Łukasz did. That's like you can start there and you're already better than many people using FEA, even if you don't understand the thing. In the course, it's exactly like that. Like I will even do their examples, like how the outcomes change when the mesh change. And that's also good. Do a very big mesh, calculate it, make it smaller, calculate it, make the mesh smaller, calculate it. It's a simple mesh convergence. And after a while, sure, you'll waste a lot of time. I'm not saying that you won't, but you do this for learning, right? After a while, you just know, oh, the mesh of this size is okay, right? So that would be it.
One point I would like to add is it's very tempting. You know, if you have a bigger model, you always have this one corner or detail that requires, you know, a higher level of meshing, even if it's not like the majority of the analysis that you're doing. And then all of a sudden, the whole computational time and everything can be, you know, determined by this detail. You have to judge.
I really like my models to be meshed nicely. So have like a smaller portion, I was like, just do the same everywhere. We can wait those few hours. So yeah, I know what you mean. And definitely, if I would do FEA, like in a competition, who does it first? I like small mesh too much to win such a competition. But definitely there is a curve there, right? So in the end, think what the outcomes mean. Like, I'm very happy that you can display all those beautiful graphics. That's great. But actually consider what the implication is. What parameters do you display and how to interpret them? It's not like having a nice drawing solves any problems. It's just a nice drawing. Think what it means. That's the most important part. And the last one, and maybe even the most important one, is start small and always be critical about your work. I mean, like, I managed to convince myself about stupid outcomes at least a few times in my career. And I was dead certain that I was right. And only someone from the outside of my thinking box could come and say, what you did here is just stupid. And then as soon as you hear it, you're like, oh, yeah, it
is. Of course, yeah.
But, like, so, you know, work with someone. Ask senior colleagues at your office. Like, don't assume that the computer showed you something, it must be correct. Most likely it's not, especially when you start. Like if you just click around and suddenly, boom, an answer pops up, it almost always wrong at the first time. I mean, like, come on. So be critical and start small. Like, don't start with a beating heart. Like, that's great. And you will get there one day, but in a decade, not in a week, right? So, like, do things that you can control. Mostly because when you do things you can control, you will catch yourself doing errors. And nobody likes that. I mean, sorry, nobody likes to find out, oh, I did it wrongly somehow. And I don't even know why. But that's the only way you can learn. And if you just do two complex things from the get-go, you get some answer, you don't know if it's correct or not, so you didn't fail, everything is fine. You won't learn doing those small steps first. That's the important part. And that's more or less it.
I mean, that's a fair closing point, Vukac. And Thanks for sharing. And I mean, just a few like follow-up questions. We had a few questions from the audience.
Sure.
I have a few questions myself. And the first one I would like to drop related to the points you just made is like, let's say you would get a report of an FEA from someone else. Mm-hmm. How would you approach that? Like what would you check? What would you find important to evaluate in such a case?
So first of all, I would ask you in this case, but obviously me in general, why am I checking this?
Right.
Like I got a report, there is a reason someone wrote this and there is a reason I've got it. And depending on those reasons, I would actually search for different things. So firstly, let's assume a simple stuff. Someone at my office finished the design, there is a report written, we have a procedure that the second person checks it, it's me, I get the model, I get the report. So first of all, I wouldn't even open the report, I would open the model, look around. But, you know, it's a luxury. When if you got an outside report, you will never get a model. They will never give it to you for many reasons, right? So I would say, okay, like if I'm checking internal stuff, I can look around, talk with the person. Like I would literally like come over. Like, what did you do? Like, what the boundary conditions are? What the loads are? Were there any troubles converging? Like,
right.
What were you thinking while meshing? Like, I would literally talk with a person to get a feel of the job, because funny enough, I've been doing FEA for so long myself that I think while I'm doing it, and it's very hard to recreate this when you read someone else's report. So what I do is I talk with the person to kind of get the vibe of solving this particular problem. It makes me easier for me to process it. So that would be one. And I would be searching for big mistakes. I know people that I employ. I know that they know what they are doing. So I'm not worried that someone would assume something like literally stupid, but there are mistakes you can do. Like, you know, maybe there is like I wouldn't check loads. We already have a procedure for that. I know that they were checked. Everything is fine, right? I would just take a look, see if I agree with hand estimates they did. And I was like, if I agree and everything was correct, it's fine, right? I would randomly select one load combination, check if it's okay. If it's okay, then this is close. I know that it's done.
Right.
But then maybe something like interpretation of outcomes. We do nonlinear FEA most of the time, so there are like equilibrium paths. Why did you assume that this is failure or that is failure? Let's see. In most cases, those are obvious things, but sometimes a good inquiry in a given direction could help. And material properties, some can be very bizarre. Checking those makes sense. Those kind of things. This is what I would search in like internal document, mostly because I have access to everything, right?
Yeah.
If I would get an external document, of course, I don't have the model. I just have what they've written.
Yeah.
There must be two cases. Like I would ask the person giving me the report, why the heck do you give me this report? Like, what do you expect, right? And if someone said, yeah, like, you know, we ordered this from another company, but we are unsure if we can build it. Can you tell us? I would say like, what does the report say? The report says it's okay. So, you know, you have a report saying it's okay. What do you want from me? Right? And if it's like, yeah, but we would like you to kind of like verify it. And I was like, look, it's impossible to do it this way. I can do this myself. I can model it. I can calculate it. And then I will be responsible for what I'm doing. But in reality, verifying someone else's job without the model, like, I mean, like, I would be able to fool myself.
right.
It's not that you can check. Like, I would say, like, look, what you expect me of me is impossible to deliver. Like this is not how it works. But let's say someone says, like, look, we got this report. They did it the best they could. We just don't know if they did it correctly. Could you take a look? So I would read the report searching for, like, hints if the person doing the report know what they are doing. I wouldn't check loads. Like, how could I? You will always write in the report that everything was verified and okay, right? But I would kind of like look at the graphics, see how the model behaves, what is written and what is omitted. And then I would try to get a vibe of a person who did it. Like if there is a phone number, because like in my reports, there is always a phone number to me. So if I would call the person and say, hey, I have this report. What do you think about the analysis, what you did? And kind of like, I would try to assess if the person is competent to do this kind of design, this level of complexity of design. Mm-hmm. And if I would say, yeah, he or she feels competent enough, I would tell to my customer, look, this is uncheckable in a sense that I cannot tell you if this is correct or not. But I've did what I can. This is state of the art. The person knows what he's doing. So there are no like philosophical or knowledge mistakes here, but if they punch the wrong number somewhere, like there is no way I can check for you. But if they have like internal control, the person is definitely qualified enough to deliver a proper response. And sadly, oftentimes I have to say like, look, those guys did the best they could. And I'm not saying that they make any obvious mistakes, but please pay attention that they didn't analyze this, they ignored that. This is like, this should be more complex, this kind of thing, right? I'm not saying that the outcome is wrong, but it's definitely lacking in certainty. So,
and I think you know, the fair point and takeaway that I'm having is that you can't really check an FEA without having the model. That's basically what you're saying, and access to the software. I mean, you can give like a general like review of it, but that's a good point. So, and you also basically answered my second question, follow-up question, is like, if you would have the model, like what steps would you check? And I think you mentioned like talking to the person, meshing, boundary conditions, convergence, and those kind of things.
Yeah. Well, I would only add that it's like when you check someone works in general, like if it's complex enough, and it doesn't have to be FEA, it can be anything really. If it's complex enough, then this means that you will basically have to do it once over to check it, because like it's too complex to just read it, right? It's not like a second grade math test where you can just read the numbers and say it's okay or not, right?
Right,
but at the same time, just the closing thought, which is a sad one too, is that usually me verifying reports leads to a situation where I notice, look, they oversimplified stuff. The analysis is like linear stuff. They ignore this, ignore that. Like sometimes it doesn't necessarily require a lot of knowledge to know that, no, this is just wrong. Like I don't know the correct answer, but this is incorrectly done. And it happens all the time. And this also means that a lot of FEA reports out there are like not the best. And I, of course, I've seen wonderful ones, obviously, right? But some that I've seen were like scary at best. So oftentimes you don't have to put a lot of effort into finding why it's completely wrong. You just have to flip it and it's like, oh. And after 5 minutes, you can go like, look, I won't investigate this further, but like, I would be careful.
Right. All right. That sounds intense. Just like maybe like a little bit of a off-topic question. Like, have you ever been involved in seeing your analyses checked? I mean, I'm always fascinated by that, like burst testing and stuff. And like people get really anxious, you know, they have to do something numerical if they design something that will be used for 20 years. And obviously they want to do their best, but the fact it won't be checked right in front of their eyes that much. But with burst testing, if you're involved with FEA and burst testing, then you just know, okay, I'm gonna put a number on the table, I think it bursts at this pressure, and then they're gonna do it, you know. How far am I off? Have you ever been involved with any of those?
I was partially only involved once in something like that, and it was a funny story. A friend of mine was writing a book about energy poles, and they did a full-scale testing of one of those. And he said, like, do you want to write a chapter on FEA to my book? And I was like, yeah, okay. I was still at university, so it made sense to write scientific stuff. So I did the calculations, and he said, like, look, those are the loads from the test. I won't tell you what the capacity is, so you can check how accurate you will be, right? And I was actually 4%. With 4% accuracy.
That's crazy.
It's very good. Like, I was like, okay.
Like, yeah, I've heard 10% and stuff like that. Yeah,
so that's like a good number. Like, I did a lot of that during my PhD because I had a lot of tests of shells, but I cannot honestly say that I benchmarked my skills. I was desperately trying to get an outcome that was close to my research, and I knew the answer up front. So, like, you know, it's not the same, but this one time I actually was close. And as it comes to, and like, you know, of course, this built confidence, right?
Right.
You can say, yeah, I did it. I'm the guy, right? But when it comes to verification of my work, this happens all the time. Of course, most of the time, well, I write very long reports that are like very well described, so I waste a lot of time on that. But when like people rarely call because they just read the report and say, like, yeah, it's fine, right? The next one. Right. So that's like the fact that I rarely hear about that means a lot to me. Like, but there were few cases where someone reached out because there is a number there. I always leave a number because, like, while I am afraid of someone checking my work, like everybody, like it's a judgment of some sort, right?
Yeah.
I'm also well aware that if we caught any mistakes that I did, if I did any, and the verifier in my office didn't catch them, like if there is a mistake, it's way better to catch it now than in 5 years. I mean, like, come on, like we can still impact this, right? So if someone is verifying, I never lie, I never hide. I will always say like, yeah, we ignored this. Yeah, we did that. Because like, you know, if the guy has a different experience than I have, like we are experts talking here, right? So I'm not a stupid dude. You're not a stupid guy. Let's find a common ground and assess if this is okay or not. So I'm friendly with those people. Yeah. And usually verifiers tend to be divided into two categories. The bigger one is people who don't know what I'm doing. Like when you do nonlinear FEA, you do like according to state of art, equilibrium paths, analysis of the outcomes. There are very few people who can read those kind of outcomes. And right. I were in situations where someone would call me and say like, could you mark what are the stress values in various parts of your model? And I was like, sure. Like if this makes you like any more confident in what we do, of course, like we sit, like do it manually to mark, like in PowerPoint, the numbers here and there. And it's like, yeah, here you are, right? So this happens. But one time a guy, I think from Sweden or from Norway, called me and said like, hey, Łukasz, I'm like reading your report for like a vessel. Like, good job. I see that you know what you're doing. I have a few questions about imperfections, if you don't mind. And I was like, yeah, dude, great. That's awesome. Like, what do you want to know? Like, how you did this? Like, we talked for like 5 minutes and he said like, yeah, clearly you know what you're doing. So thanks. Like, I just wanted to make sure. I was like, yeah, thank you. Right. I appreciate you calling, right? So this happens too. But like, I try not to verify other report unless there is a good reason to, because I think that I would be a very bad person. Like, I would have a lot of like, why didn't you do this? Why you did that? Like, I would be like a pain. Like I don't want people to go through that. And also, I promised myself that I will never go into like a court of law. By this, I mean like, you know, something happened and now the court is searching for an expert to assess something. I'm like, no, I'm like, I would be too brutal to someone. And I cannot assume that someone would have like, you know, the time and the budget and the skill set to do this as I would do it. And like punching someone in those cases, this is not like something I would do. So,
yeah. So I mean, you know, just thinking about the answer you gave and the 4%, it would be nice just as a food for thought to have those benchmarks available for students, right? Just like a cantilever buckling
like in the course, there are like 5 examples that I start from start to the end. And I always encourage people, try yourself first. And like, just so you know how many stupid mistakes you can do along the way, because like when you watch it first and then you know what I did, it's okay. But when you start yourself and then you see like, oh, why did he
do that?
Like I explained that I didn't support the model this way, I supported it in the other way, and look how the outcomes change. Like when you start yourself first, you can find yourself in that, right? So that would be good. Of course, the problem is that when you start, it's like you cannot really rely on test data, because with like the entry level, let's say first 5 years into FEA, maybe 3 years, you would be very hard pressed to redo numerically an experimental test. Too many non-linearities are involved, too many complexities. You want to start with something simple. Nobody does experimental stuff on simple things because, like, why would they?
That's a fair point.
So it's not that you can have like, oh, we tested like 78 spoons and now you can, you know, do stuff with them and see what happens. Like, I actually do have a plan that one day, you know, when what I do will become like popular enough to warrant some things like that, I will actually go to the lab of some sort, hire them to do various tests of stupid things, just so I can do benchmarks. But like, it requires a lot of time, effort, and budget to do those things. So it's not here yet. It's not there yet.
I actually built it
as simple like test strength machine. There's this device measure force, and there is a string to a Lego device that pulls the string, so you can actually measure how strong you pull it. And then if you measure like deformations, you can actually destroy something very light. But I never get the time to play around with that.
I can imagine. All right, so let's discuss some questions we had from the audience.
Sure, of course.
Let me just have a look. So Milot is asking a question related to stress singularities. Can you say in brief what the solution is to deal with stress singularities due to toe of the fillet welds? I mean, that's a very specific question, of course. Any thoughts? You know, toe of welds is always an issue with singularities, like how to approach this.
Yeah, well, Milot, like there is so much to unpack here. First of all, why do you even have modeled a weld in your model? Like, because my experience is that in many cases, it's actually better to do the FEA without welds and calculate welds by hand. Because, like, let's face it, weld is a very complex thing. Like, you change the metallurgic structure of the metal you connect. So will you take that into account? Like, what about heat you produce while welding? There are residual stresses. Are you intending to have that in your model? And so on and so forth. There are a lot of complexities. And now, if you say, okay, I will design the weld by hand, and in most cases, you can relatively easily. The code procedures already include all that. They did a lot of tests, like they did a lot of tests on strength of welds. So you can just calculate them by hand according to the code rule. Those are usually quite simple. And then you can say, okay, since it follows the code rules, everything will be fine. And if you say, no, I want to do it in FEA, it's always a question of how much are you willing to ignore, hoping that it doesn't influence your outcome too much. Because otherwise, you would basically have to model the welding process, how the heat distributes, and then how the metallurgy changes. Like, you won't do that, right? So you have to cut this off at some level. And the question is, what level are you willing to accept as a cutoff? So let's say I'm ignoring the heat, I'm ignoring the residual stresses, I just want to calculate, like, the static of the weld, let's say, right? The question is, why would you? Like, designing it by code makes more sense. So let's say you do fatigue, right? Because, like, that would be a very common thing, in which case I would say go to International Institute of Welding recommendation. They actually tell, when you have a 2D mesh, how to calculate stresses manually from your FEA model. You just mesh your model according to a specific scheme they very well describe. You extrapolate the stresses from the connected elements to the place where the weld is. And based on that extrapolation, you can assess the fatigue life of your component, of your weld. So that would be a very good workaround. I'm not a big fan of modeling welds in your model because, frankly, I don't think that's a good idea. Like, most of the time, it's just not. Of course, you can tell me, yeah, but you know, I have this heart pacifier, and it's like micro dot welded somewhere, and I need to know whatever, right? In which case, I would say, like, you need an extremely complex FEA model to deal with that. Right. And if your answer is, yeah, I don't need such a complex model, then doing by hand, it's most likely better for you.
All right. I mean, that's a nice point. I mean, I've experienced workarounds being included in some of the codes. For example, the ASME boiler pressure vessel code, division 2, chapter 5, which I mentioned before, you know, having linearization options to avoid doing detailed modeling.
But they also have, like, allowed weld schemes where there are, like, tables which shows you how you can weld the components in a way that it's acceptable and you don't have to check all of things for those components, right? So just following the guidelines would be, like, the simplest solution there, I think.
Yeah, that makes sense. Let's jump to another question. One from Himanand. Himanand, thanks for asking this question. FEA provides different post-processing options, centroidal and corner nodal values, average and maximum values. What is your advice based on your experience, or how do you approach this? Like, do you always use maximum, average? What is your take on that?
Stress averaging in elements is a very funny thing. Luckily, it usually is important when you do linear FEA. Because when you do non-linear FEA, there is a cutoff of yielding and, like, you know, you're fine, right? But if you do linear analysis, you can have extremely different values between, like, maximal centroid only and stuff, right? And the question is, isn't it a problem in its own? Like, if you have a single element and those values differ so much, maybe there's a problem with meshing. Like, maybe smaller elements would lead to a better, like, I don't want to use convergence in this context, but maybe it would lead to like smaller differences you will be okay with, you know, because like, if you think about it, like, it wouldn't work, by the way, because of roundup errors and stuff like that. But if you like infinitely small finite element, the centroid, maximal and minimal stress is basically one value, right? So as you go with smaller and smaller elements, that should help. And this is like usually a thing when you have too big mesh and suddenly you end up in a situation where maximal, minimal centroid values, there are like 20 different types you can have, by the way, and all of them are different. And now what? Right? Exactly. And if they are too different, make smaller elements. That would be like a good one. And of course, like, if you're not certain, just pick the worst one you can generate for your, like, I'm not saying the biggest one, because the biggest one may not necessarily be the worst one in your case, but pick the worst one. And if it's okay for the worst one, most likely everything is fine, right? But if you feel, oh, the difference is big, this is a meshing problem, not analyzing of outcomes problem. But to answer better your question, we usually display like centroid values, but we have very small elements. So this is like how I would approach it in general. But you know, like, if you do nonlinear FEA, like, you expect all those values to be the yield strength, like the basically. Yeah. So it's not like it's not a big thing. It's a linear thing, linear FEA thing. So yeah.
All right. Thanks for commenting. I have two more questions. I mean, we've been going on for a little over one and a half hours now. Thank you for
sticking up with us for so long too.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, we've had long conversations in the past, so I'm going to make sure that we won't go on indefinitely. Two more questions, Łukasz. A little bit more like playful questions, general questions, like, a flying object. It's a comment made by Suraj. Suraj, thanks for asking. How would you approach a flying object, you know, related to boundary conditions? Let's say the wing of an airplane at flight, right?
Well, first of all, the wing of an airplane is attached to a plane. So it is supported in some sense. Like, I must say, first of all, I'm a random guy from the internet, and it so happens that I'm a civil engineer. So the only flying object I can think of is a beer bottle. Right? But like, I never designed a plane in my life, although I would love to design something that will go to space once, but not tomorrow. If you're in like the flying, as far as I understand it, and trust me, I don't. There are rules governed by industry on how you would support a model like that. I think that Dominique Madier, in his book for practical finite element analysis, have example of planes, and he discusses how he would like support those. And I know next to nothing about it. I never did a plane. I don't know. So that's one. But secondly, most likely you don't design an entire plane. I mean, like, and how do you calculate plane in general? Right, there must be some sort of rules, like there is drag and uplift and all that, right? So obviously there are rules in which you calculate the plane, not in FEA, but like at all, in general, right? And those rules work, so the plane is in equilibrium of some sort. So one part of the things in equilibrium could be the support, while the other part of the equilibrium would be the active load, and those would sum up to a model that is stable. Right? Because it has to be like that.
It has to be, yeah.
I'm not familiar with the rules. Like, I would be able to calculate that if I knew an aviation engineer who would tell me, like, look, the plane flies because this and that, and this is what we do, and so on. But without this guidance, I wouldn't be able to help you with this particular question in detail. But I'm sure that in many companies there are like senior engineers that just know it because it's their work. And they support those models all the time. So,
right. Yeah. All right. Thanks.
You can also model like particular parts, like a single wing. You can assume that it's attached to a plane, loaded as it is loaded, and see what happens. Right. The problem is that at some point you run out of things you attach to, because like it would be very bad to have like entire plane attached to a radio wire somewhere. There.
Exactly. Yeah.
And then also if you do things in space, there is something called matrix stabilization, where you would add small numbers to stiffness matrix, just so you don't have perfect zeros on diagonal. And because in space, you know, it's like you're perfectly in equilibrium, but of force equilibrium. There are no supports, right? So you can stabilize matrix and deal with this somehow, but I'm foggy on details. It was just a remark on one of the lectures I was attending to. So.
Yeah. That's all right. I mean, thanks for commenting. And in the meantime, there's also been some comments on this in the chat, which is perfect. Dominic is commenting, Dominic Magier, the best method. I think it's like you mentioned the book just now.
Okay.
So Dominic Magier, the best method for flying for a flying aircraft is an isostatic method, the 3-2-1 rule. I have no knowledge about that myself, so thanks.
That would be an idea that you kind of like only support the model to be stable, and then you apply all the rest as loads, basically.
So, as far
as I know, but Dominic is way better in aviation because he's like aerospace engineer. So
All right. Thanks, Dominic, for commenting. Second, final question for you, Vukaj, is: have you ever been involved in composite materials, so fiber reinforced plastics? Interesting field.
Yeah, I only touched on it once, but there was no business case for me in that. So no, not really. I know the concepts. I did some reading on it. I think that I will know where to start searching. But if I would ever go serious about it, I would first have to design a few things, crush them in the lab, and see what happens. I wouldn't be courageous enough to say, hey, let's design a plane made of fibers. No, this is not how I do things. So I'm not skilled enough to give any decent advice in the field. I'm foggily aware of what's involved, but definitely not enough to do the calculations of my own.
All right. That's a fair and straightforward answer. Thanks. With that, I would like to wrap up this session. I mean, thanks for your time, Vukaj. We've talked for well over 1.5 hours, as I mentioned. And thanks, everyone, joining us today. And I'd just like to highlight, you know, if you want to know more about FEA, feel free to check out the FEA Essentials course, which is also named the Breakthrough FEA course, which can be found on enterfea.com and on engineeringtrainer.com. Vukaj has a great blog on enterfea.com/blog, which I would highly recommend, and also check out his YouTube channel. And in the meantime, if you feel that this type of content is useful for you and for your colleagues at work, check out the engineeringtrainer.com portfolio and connect with me to discuss what an enterprise account for your team would mean. On that note, thanks everyone for joining us. Thanks, Vukaj.
For your patience too. Like it was quite
A long session.
Thank you for bringing up.
Exactly. A lot of topics. Have a great day to all of you.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you for having me too.